Sponsored by Jacobs and VivaStar.
What is this place?
Welcome to Guerrilla Warfare and the hairy universe of Tim Burton's Planet of the Apes. Over the next 30 minutes, we'll be taking you inside the reimagining of the classic sci-fi epic as we meet the cast, see how they were transformed from human to simian, and enroll at Ape School for one of this summer's most eagerly awaited movies. Straddling a period of Cold War paranoia, hippie rebellions, and a new world order, 1968's Planet of the Apes became an international phenomenon, serving up sci-fi chills with social realism.
Security police!
I'm in charge of this man!
No longer, madam. He is now in the custody of the Ministry of Science.
Take your stinking paws off me, you damn dirty ape!
Bursting through as one of 20th Century Fox's biggest hits of that decade, grossing $28 million on a $6 million budget, the original Planet spawned four sequels, a TV series, and a banana boatload of merchandise. So, it was only a matter of time that, with a whole new generation waiting to be tapped, that resuscitating the Ape franchise might just be worthwhile.
Since it's been through all the other movies, a TV show, some lunchboxes, you know, some trading cards, it's been through the ringer. You know, it was time to just do a different version of it.
When Burton was first approached about a new Planet of the Apes, the director, fresh from the success of Sleepy Hollow, was wary. Insisting that he would not helm neither a remake nor a sequel, he couldn't resist the perverse pleasures to be had from tackling the big budget glories of the sacred ape.
I was daunted to begin with because it's such a classic movie. It's really a classic of its time. That's why it was a wise decision not to do a remake, because you can't, you know, Charlton Heston, you got elements and the time that cannot be duplicated or bettered, you know, because it was a movie that had a lot of impact for me. So we tried to do little symbols and things that were part of the mythology, but do it in a different way.
This one looked at me.
You dirty human!
You know, I got into the material and I realized that I like people who act like animals, you know?
With a refreshingly off-center view on filmmaking, the energetic and oddly charismatic director, who brought us such fantastical treats as Beetlejuice, Edward Scissorhands, and Mars Attacks, was seen as the ideal choice to make the cinema-going population all monkey-feely all over again.
I couldn't think of a more perfect pairing than Planet of the Apes and Tim Burton. It just spells magic. It's a reimagination of that basic idea. That basic what if you walked into a world that was turned on its head, a world that was dominated by apes.
For Planet of the Apes 2001, the central premise remains the same. An astronaut crash lands on an alien world, soon discovering that it's time to bow down before the ape we serve.
Next, you'll be telling us these beasts have a soul.
Of course they do.
The senator's daughter flirts with blasphemy.
Is there a soul in there?
For his Stranger in a Strange Land, Burton needed someone who could ground the movie in reality.
What we're doing with this is we're trying to make the ape world a bit crazier, a bit weirder that way. And what it needed was just somebody, it's almost like an old style of movie acting, which that real simple, like, you know, when you get there and he sees it, he looks at it, it's just with a very simple look, it's like, where in the hell am I?
And the man to fit that description was Mark Wahlberg, the former bad boy rapper with a tendency to flash flesh, come part-time model, and now fully-fledged movie star, who accepted the challenge after the briefest of meetings with Burton at his LA home.
The meeting lasted literally 2 minutes. I walked in, said hi, we had met before, and he said, you know, we don't have a script, and, you know, until you get to know Tim, he's not always very clear. I think he does it on purpose, which is cool. I like that a lot. I said, you know, he's doing this thing. And I said, well, if you want me, I'm in. and, you know, we didn't talk about specifics. It wasn't about, you know, the role or anything. And a couple days later, I got a call. He said he wanted me to do it. And then the worrying started.
When filming began in November last year, the enormity of what Wahlberg had let himself in for became apparent as soon as shooting began.
Well, it hit me the first day of shooting. I had a bit of a panic attack. I'm looking down and there's a furry foot in a sandal. And I look up and there's this guy in this gorilla outfit. I'm just like, I don't know how to do this. I really don't know how to do this. And, you know, started to search through the crowd on the set and finally saw Tim, and he was enthusiastic as ever, and, you know, that was the reassurance that I needed.
Joining Wahlberg in playing the only human female who challenges the apes is model-turned-actress Estella Warren as Dana.
She's so angry, you know, about the dynamic between the apes and the humans. I mean, they've repressed her society for so long, and she craves equality. She's very physical in her character. I mean, the way she holds her body and the way that she looks at people, a lot of her expressions had to come out through her body and the emotions through her eyes, because, you know, humans aren't allowed to look at the apes and humans aren't supposed to speak to the apes. So, you know, when she gets the chance to, she's still a little bit scared of it.
How the hell did these monkeys get like this?
What other way would they be?
They'd be begging me for a treat right now.
What tribe are you from?
U.S. Air Force, I'm going back to it.
Leading the ape army is Tim Roth, who turned down the opportunity to star in the first Harry Potter movie in favor of apes, and who revels as Thade, a mentally unbalanced chimpanzee intent on human genocide.
Unfortunately, it was like, you know, you've got to make some kind of decision. I've always wanted to work with Tim Burton. Always wanted. I love his films. It's really fun, and I wanted to go to Tim Burton land.
Tim has an evil chimp quality in his personality that I thought was really good.
I just thought he was like a sexy kind of ape. I saw a sexy beast.
I'm more scared of a chimp than I am a gorilla, truthfully, because I find them crazier. You know, everybody, you know, they have this air of cuteness, but they're evil. They can rip your head off at any second.
You're only going to get, you know, one shot at this kind of stuff. So why not do your homework and put some convincing movement together or some weird movement and stuff together that the audience is really going to like.
Assisting Thade is Michael Clark Duncan, who plays a giant military commander.
I play Attar. He's the general of the ape army. And Attar is second in command to Tim Roth's character. And my job is to make sure that the ape army is run correctly under the rule of Tim Roth's character, who's Thade, who's very crazy and wicked.
Kill them all.
That is my boss, and whatever orders he gives me, I carry them out with a strict vengeance.
Form the divisions.
Form divisions!
As Limbo, Paul Giamatti plays a rather shifty-looking orangutan who deals in human slaves.
He's just trying to make a living. He's just trying to get to the end of the day and have a drink, have a sit, put his feet up and have a drink and just relax and everybody leave him alone.
And as Ari, Helena Bonham Carter completes the cast as a chimp who takes an unusually sympathetic view to the humans and in particular to Leo and his attempt to escape from the apes.
I'm a sort of human rights activist. I mean, I'm just a radical and I'm somebody who just like cannot bear injustice and mistreatment of humans and fellow sort of beings.
You know me, just can't stand by while human beings are being mistreated, tortured, mutilated.
I sort of rescue Mark Wahlberg from a local slave trade and sort of adopt him as my sort of pet human.
Is there another way out of the city?
I can show you the way.
Unlike all the other humans, he's got a sort of unbroken spirit. He's sort of rebellious. I think I've just got a crush on him, to be honest.
That's where I flew in.
You did that?
No, my retro burners.
Shall I explain everything?
There's no way to explain what can't exist.
Talking monkeys can't exist.
Monkeys are further down the evolutionary ladder. Just above humans.
So there you have it. That's it for part one. But stay tuned, because on the way after the break, we delve deeper inside Planet Burton for more Monkey Mania as we enroll at Ape School, go face-to-face with makeup man extraordinaire Rick Baker, composer Danny Elfman, and remix maestro Paul Oakenfold get busy on the soundtrack and we reveal some of the strangest sights seen on set during the making of Planet of the Apes.
I have pictures in my house of that, you know, when the still photographer came and said, do you want any pictures? I said, yeah, I want a picture of this guy, eating with the mirror. It was wild.
Sponsored by Jacobs and VivaStar.
Sisters of Soul, all weekend.
Swimming?
Swimming.
Coffee?
Great dogs.
Great pool.
Great coffee.
TV Ibiza 2001 is almost here, and you could go for free. MTV is giving away 2 VIP tickets for you and your best mate, plus flights and accommodation. And 20 runners-up will receive advanced copies of our MTV Ibiza CD. So pay attention. Which of the following will perform live at MTV Ibiza 2001? Answers to this address or email at mtvibizacompetition@mtvne.com. MTV Ibiza 2001. Don't miss out.
Sponsored by Jacobs and VivaStar.
Welcome back to part 2 of our look inside Planet of the Apes.